Morning, history students. Today is day 4.3, and today we are talking about one of my favorite topics, the American West. But before I get into the topic, I want to talk about a few things that I am seeing. First, in your historiographical books and topics and books assignment, there are still a few of you who are choosing collections of essays, which will not work. Okay, so if you chose a collection of essay for your book, you turned in the assignment and you got a zero. Okay, that is because you need to rethink that book that is a collection of essays. The other thing I'm seeing, a few of you think this is a world history class or European history class and are choosing a topic that is not U.S. history. So please, please, please choose a topic that is U.S. history from Columbus's voyage until now. Okay, U.S. history, not any other country. You could choose, you know, something that relates to that other country, U.S. relations with that other country, something like that, but please choose something that's U.S. history. Please choose something that is a book, books that are not compilations of essays edited by somebody. If the book says edited by somebody, it's a no-no. If it says by somebody, then that probably will work. Okay, so went through the ones that were turned in last night, and went through those. Most of them were good, but like I said, some of them were collections of essays. Some of them chose a topic that was not U.S. history. So please rethink. If you got a zero on that assignment and already turned it in, please rethink your books. A lot of you, I made suggestions on books if you chose collections of essays, and I will from time to time. But even if I make a suggestion, you've got to resubmit that assignment to get your points back. Okay, it has to be submitted in Canvas to get your points back. Okay. All right. The other thing is going through the oral history research papers, and on the most part, they're pretty good. The one thing that some of them are seriously lacking is personal reflection, and that's a shame. That's the easiest part to write. So if I haven't graded your oral history research paper, you realize, oh, maybe I don't have that much personal reflection. Go ahead and revamp it, and then turn it back in. And that's about it for housekeeping stuff. Furiously grading, almost done with week three stuff finally, and I'm graded about 10 of your oral history research papers, and I'll probably grade 10 more or more hopefully today. So just keep being patient with me. Okay, now for today's topic, American West history. And the main draw of this for today is a PowerPoint that I made based on an article by Clyde Milner, who happens to be one of my favorite undergrad professors. Not the complete reason that I chose that, but amazing man. In that PowerPoint, it entitled America Only More So, it talks about both the significance and the insignificance of Western history, and that's going to be your questions to choose from. Is Western history significant, or is it insignificant? And the case for being significant, obviously, is the story of the American West is the story of United States history. For instance, when settlers first came over, the West was the East Coast. That is west of where they were. And the West keeps being redefined and going farther and farther west. And in that article that this PowerPoint is based from, Milner suggests that Andrew Jackson, okay, 7th President of the United States, prided himself on being a Westerner, but he was from Tennessee. But back in his time, Tennessee was the West. And that is what I mean by the shifting West. But the notion of the West is, hey, let's move West for greener pastures, the chance to own land, the chance to make ourselves better economically. At first it was, hey, let's farm this land. And some of them ran into trouble thinking, oh, crap, you know, this is an arid West. It doesn't have much precipitation to grow crops. That was a challenge. But also, obviously, people went west to mine the resources. Okay, mining was a huge deal in the West and shaped a lot of Western history, as well as other, the gold rush, obviously, which we just talked about. Timber, also a biggie. Those kind of things shaped the economy in the West. But obviously farming was number one. That was the main reason people came over. But those other economic forces, driving forces, were big as well. The West is, and Milner mentions this, a varied landscape. You can see it in our own county. We've got a varied landscape. We've got arid deserts, just sagebrush for miles. We've got mountains, mountainous areas like Pine Valley and Kolob Terrace. We've got we've got almost rainforest-ish stuff in Zion with the ferns and the hanging gardens and Weeping Rock. I joke with my daughters that is a place in our county that rains year-round. They go, ha ha, yeah, right, Dad. But anyway, just the varied landscape that we have here, and obviously large expanses of Red Rock and Snow Canyon, Red Cliffs Desert Preserve, which is unfortunately on fire right now, as you've probably seen. But so just varied landscape, but also the West, and Milner mentions this, is a huge melting pot of people from somewhere else. We've got the Asians, Japanese, Chinese that came over. We've got obviously Native Americans all over. This is their native land, and we've got people from other places. And Milner says that this is a kind of an oxymoron, that all these people from every place pride themselves on being Westerners. And that's one of the things that he talks about, which is very interesting. Other things that he talks about with the shifting boundaries of the West throughout U.S. history, he mentions that historians of the American West even today cannot decide its borders. And one of the things that is in that PowerPoint that's pretty fun is a survey done at the 1993 conference of the Western Historical Association, I believe 1993, but anyway, and the survey is, what are the boundaries of the West? And there was no firm decision from these Western historians about where the true boundary of the West is. Some say that it is the West is the firmly west of the Mississippi River. Some say that it's the where there is 20 inches or less of rain, weather can go in the defining of the West. Some say, oh, it's just the mountain states, starting with Colorado, the eastern border of Colorado West, that kind of idea. So that's interesting to see that graphic. Some of them argue, oh, is the coast of California really in the West? Are Hawaii, are Alaska really in the West? But if you don't remember anything from my discussion today, my topic today, please remember that we here in Utah live in the unambiguous West. Okay, that's one thing that the historians could agree on, is that Utah, Nevada, Arizona, New Mexico, Idaho, I believe was the other one, are firmly in the West. So we are in the unambiguous West. So please note that. And then Miller goes on to talk about certain Western issues, talking about that the West was settled with this archetype, with these male archetypes that are rough and tough, and seeking adventure, and that the West is a place of individuality. But then goes on to say, well, gee, it's the West more than any other place, because it was later on the scene, which is the most land is owned by the federal government. For instance, in Nevada, I think it's like 89% of Nevada is owned by the federal government. Utah, it's 60 something percent. And then it also talks about how the West being this open, rugged country, but and it's gotten the most government help, but obviously also because it's later on the scene. Other things he talks about are the Native Americans. He says that those, from the 1890s especially, if they saw what was going on today with Native Americans, they would be astounded, because Native Americans, which we'll talk about next time, the government was trying to stamp out, especially the culture, and to stamp out Indians themselves. In 1890s, the Native American population was roughly 250,000, and obviously today it is much more. I can't remember the time of his writing how much it was. I think it was 2 million something, or other. But he said that the 1890s, people from the 1890s would be astounded, because the Indian population has rebounded, their culture continues, thank goodness, and so that is a good thing about the West. The other thing about the West that he notes is the misconceptions. People think that, it's just a bunch of cowboys and cowboys and Indians, basically. But it is not, obviously. We know the true history. And he shows, pictures of, talks about, Clint Eastwood, John Wayne, those folks, the male archetypes known for violent actions. That's who everybody thinks were responsible for, settlement of the West, but it really wasn't, obviously. And so that is a kind of a huge, huge thing about the history of the West, is all these misconceptions because of popular media, mainly Western movies. And in these Western movies, it's the white men, obviously, in white hat, the white hats are the good guys, the black hats are the bad guys. Usually the formulaic Western goes, the main character, the hero, in his white hat, usually, he has been wronged by somebody, stolen his cattle, they've kidnapped his wife or his intended, or they've killed somebody in his family. And so this person, this white man, is trying to get revenge. And, Indians are, in these Western movies, seen as savages. Hardly any Latino or black or Asian representation in these movies, which is a shame, because those people played a huge role in the West. Those groups played a huge role in the West. But women, are just seen as, in the backdrop, helping a little bit. But one of the articles you can read this week talks about the significance of women in the West, and it is huge. There were actually women doctors in the West. They were more than just the saloon dancers or the school teachers, which is or prostitutes, which is how we see women in the West. Those are the roles that we see women in the West, but this article is great. It talks about how there were women who were doing much more than just that. There were women business owners, and obviously behind every good man, usually, there is a good woman, and that's what the article is showing. So, your discussion board question for this week is a fun one, and this is one I love to talk about in class, is what movie, TV show, product, work of art, what thing like that has defined the West to you? So what movie, what TV show, What product, what artwork has defined the West for you and why? And that's kind of a fun one. And to end on, I'll tell my own, okay? As I was saying, you know, these formulaic Western plots, you know, I grew up with a father who was way into John Wayne, way into Western movies. So I've watched probably most of the John Wayne movies there are. And as we were watching John Wayne movies, I was like, oh yeah, you know, another formulaic plot. I thought John Wayne was pretty stiff as an actor, and was astounded to learn that he won Best Actor for True Grit in 1969. But anyway, so I watched a lot of those with my dad. I thought, these are, you know, pretty boring, pretty predictable. But then my parents showed me Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. Came out in 1969. And that movie got me hooked on the history of the West, but also hooked on the story of Butch Cassidy. After watching that movie, I wanted to know the real story of Butch Cassidy, what really happened. And that was in eighth grade, and I have been just fascinated with Butch Cassidy ever since. More than just the fascinating story that it was a story of a real person, the way that Butch Cassidy and Sundance Kid is not your formulaic Western, because number one, the dialogue is so much better than the stiff, stuffy Westerns that I was used to. The banter back and forth between Butch and Sundance in that movie is just much more entertaining than any regular Western. But number two, it broke the mold in the fact that the protagonists in the movie, okay, were actually bad guys. They were outlaws. And they were the ones being chased rather than the formulaic Western movie where the good guys, the protagonists in the movie, are the ones doing the chasing. And so I thought, man, this is great because it breaks the mold. Also, it's great because it is, part of it is filmed right here in our own county. Grafton is a backdrop, major backdrop. You remember the scene where Butch is riding the bike with Catherine Ross playing At a Place, Butch played by Paul Newman, riding the bike to the tune of Raindrops Keep Falling on My Head. Some of the chase scenes in Snow Canyon. So that is another reason that I love the movie, because its backdrop is here in our own backyard. But anyway, if you haven't seen that movie, check it out. That is a movie that really defined West for me, because it started a lifelong fascination with Butch Cassidy. I've read, you know, so many books on Butch Cassidy. Love it. His life is fascinating because nobody can decide on, you know, what robberies he really committed with his gang. Nobody can decide where and when he really died. You know, some say that he died in a shootout with Bolivian troops in 1908. A lot of old-timers and family members swear they saw him after that supposed shootout in 1908. Saw him alive and well in the United States. So that is what's fun about Butch Cassidy, and we will probably never know definitively what really happened to him, and that is what makes it so much fun. But anyway, Western history is fun because it's been in the media, you know, so much for so long. You know, it didn't start with Western movies. It started with the dime novels in the 19th century when the West was still going on. These people wrote the dime novels who had never even been to the West, just making up stories. For instance, there was a dime novel about Kit Carson. Okay, Kit Carson couldn't read. Their book was read to him, but he said, "That didn't happen to me." And so, you know, people making up stories about the West from the get-go. So it's nothing new, but it is here to stay. And it will stay because it is so much fun, and people just can't leave it alone. So anyway, signing off for today. Hopefully you enjoy your study of the West today, and we will see you in our Google Meet next Tuesday, bright and early, 7 a.m. for those of you who have that class, 9:15 a.m. for the other class, and we will hope my internet at home works and doesn't cut out. Okay, have a good weekend. See you Tuesday. Thanks.